Hey there, how's it going everybody? In this video, we're going to take an in-depth look at the request library. So the request library allows us to easily make HTTP requests to get information from websites. Now, I believe it's the most downloaded Python package, and there's a good reason for that. It does a really good job of taking tasks that used to be complicated and confusing, and instead makes them easy and intuitive. So that's why the tagline for the request library is HTTP for humans. Now, we've used the request library in a lot of previous videos to get information from websites, but there's so much more that we can do with the library that we haven't looked at yet. So that's what we'll be doing in this video. So we'll learn how to get information from websites, but also see how to post information, download images, send authentication information for basic logins and forms, follow redirects, and things like that. So let's go ahead and get started. So first of all, let's look at the basics and just see how to get basic information from a website. Now, one thing that I should mention is that the request library is great for getting information from a website, but it's not meant to parse that information. So if you want to parse the information that you get from the website, then you'll use something like Beautiful Soup. And I already have a video on Beautiful Soup, so if you're interested in how to parse this information, then I'll leave a link to that video in the description section below. And there's also a newer parser called request-html, and that's written by the same person who wrote this request library, and I'll be doing a video on that in the near future. So first, to use the request library, we need to install it. So you can do this with a simple pip command. So I'm going to open up my terminal here. You can open up your terminal or command line, and we can just install that with pip install request. And this should be a fairly quick download. Okay, so that is done. And once that's installed, go ahead and create a new module so that we can work with this. So I have a new module here called rdemo.py. So first, let's simply grab the contents of a website. So I'm going to use the URL for an XKCD comic about Python. So I have this pulled up in my browser here. So if I go over to my page here, so this is just a funny webcomic about Python. And if any of you have ever done import anti-gravity from a Python script, then this is the comic that pops up. So let's say that I wanted to request this page through Python using requests. So first, let's just copy this URL. So I'm going to go up here and copy the URL. And now let's go back to our empty module. And now I can first import the request library. So I'll say import request. And to get that page, we can simply say r is equal to request.get. And within a string, we will paste that URL. And now let's just print out r, which should be the response of that web page. So if I run that, then we can see that we get this response object. And that tells us that we got a 200 response. So now let's see how we can get the content from this web page. So if you ever wanted to see all of the attributes and methods available to you from a specific object, you can simply run it through this dir function here. So if we run that object into dir, save that and run it. Let me make this a little larger here. Then it should show us the attributes and methods that we can access within this response object. So you can see here that we have content, headers, is redirect, JSON, links, an OK status, and status code, and things like that. Now, if you'd ever like to see a more detailed explanation of an object's attributes and methods, then you can run it through the help function. So if I come up here and instead of dir, we say help and print out the help of this response object. So let me run that. Now I'll scroll up here to the top. You can see we have a lot more to scroll through, but it gives us a much more detailed explanation of everything from this object. So for example, let me make this a little larger again. If I scroll down here to content, so scrolling past, and we can see that content is equal to the content of the response in bytes. So that would be good for images and things like that. Now, if we scroll down to text, so scroll down a little further here, this says content of the response in Unicode. So let's use this one to get the content of the page that we're currently on, and we'll look at using the content in bytes to grab an image right after this. So up here, instead of printing out the help, I'm instead going to print out r.text. And again, that should give us the content of the response in Unicode. So if I save that and run it, then you can see that we get some HTML here. So this is the HTML for the page that we just looked at in the browser. And again, if you'd like to parse out this information, then I'd suggest using an HTML parser to do that. Okay, so that's how you get the source of the website. But let's say that you wanted to download an image. So if you wanted to download an image, then you'd want to use content, which gives you the content of the response in bytes. So if we go back to that web page in the browser, if I look here at the bottom of this comic, then we can see that it gives us an image URL for this comic. So let me copy this and paste it in here into a new tab. And we can see that this is just the image of the comic. So let's go ahead and download this using Python. So again, I'm going to copy the URL to that image. And now let's go back to our script. And up here in request.get, I'm going to paste the URL to that image. So now, if we were to print this content instead of text, if I print this out, then that prints out the bytes from that image. So we can take those bytes and save those to a file on our machine. So to do this, I'm just going to overwrite my print statement here, and I'm going to say with open and open a new file here, and I will just call this comic.png, and we want to open this in WB mode, which is write bytes, and we'll just open that as F, and within that context manager, I'll say F.write, which will write to the file. We will write the content of that response, so r.content. Now, if you're not familiar with reading and writing files, then I do have a separate video on that if you'd like to learn more about it in depth. And I'll leave a link to that video in the description section below if anyone is interested. But this code that we wrote is going to save this file in the same directory as our Python module, since we didn't specify a full path in the open function. So if we run this and open the directory where this Python module is located, then there should be an image saved there as well. So I'm going to save this and run it. And we don't get any output down here because we didn't print anything out. But I have the directory open where I wrote this module. And we can see that we have the comic.png right here. And if I open that up, we can see that it is the comic from that website. Okay, so now let me close that down and go back to our module here. Okay, so now let's look at some other basic information from our response. So let's say that we just want to check if we got a good response. Now, I do this a lot if I'm writing a script to monitor a website and just want to make sure that my responses are coming back all right. So we can check the status code simply by saying, I'm just going to get rid of writing to that file there. I'm going to say print r.status_code. So if I run that, then we can see that we got a 200 response from the site. Now, if you don't know your HTTP status codes, basically the 200s are a success. The 300s are redirects. The 400s are client errors, like if you try to access a page that you don't have permission to view or something like that. And 500 errors are server errors. Those are the errors that you'll see when a site just crashes and you can't access it for some time. Now, if you're monitoring a site for errors, then you probably only care if you're getting a client error or a server error, and everything else is an okay response. So if that's the case, then Request has made it easy on you where you can just print out r.okay. So if I save that and run it, then that will return true for anything that is less than a 400 response. So if you get any kind of client or server error, then that would return false. So for example, I'll probably write a script soon that monitors my personal website. And if I get a response that isn't okay, then I'll send myself an email that something is up with that. And I'll use something like this in that script. And I'll probably make a video soon on writing a monitor script like that if anyone is interested. Okay, so you can also view some more in-depth response information by looking at the headers. So if I print out r.headers, then we can see, let me make this a little larger here. Then we can see that we get all of the headers that come back with the response. So it's telling us that the server is Nginx, the content type is image PNG, and a bunch of other stuff that you might find useful. Okay, so now let's look at some more advanced features of Request Library. Now for the rest of the video, I'm going to use a site called httpbin.org that allows us to test different queries. So let me open this up in the browser so we can see what this looks like. So this site was actually written by the same guy who wrote the Request Library, and I'll never understand how some of these people are so productive and can create so many awesome tools, but I'm really glad that these people exist because they do some awesome work. So this site will show us the different routes available to us and what it allows us to test. So we can test different HTTP methods like get, post, put, delete, and things like that. We can test redirects if we want to test redirects. We can see here that we can test authentication and all kinds of different stuff. So for example, let's say that you wanted to do a GET request on a route that has some URL parameters. So I'm going to use the HTTP bin GET route to test this. And the way that he's set this site up is that HTTP bin is going to respond with JSON information of what we sent in the request so that we can make sure that we set all of the parameters properly. So let's take a look at an example here. So I'm going to open up my script here in Sublime. So like I said, I'm going to use request to pass some URL parameters with our request. So the HTTP bin route for their GET request is going to be HTTPS httpbin.org/GET. Now, usually you can pass URL parameters directly in the URL, and you've probably seen these before. So these are things in the URL that look like, you know, question mark, page equals 2, and then an ampersand sign there, count equals 25 or something like that. Now we can still add parameters to the URL directly like this if we wanted to, but adding them to the URL directly like that can be prone to mistakes. So the request library actually lets us pass these in as a dictionary and then generates the appropriate URL for us. So what we can do, let me remove these parameters here from the URL. Let me go up a line here. I'm just going to say payload is equal to, and now let's create a dictionary of those parameters. So, you know, the key can be page and we can have a value of 2, and then I can have a key of count and put in a value of 25. So now when we make this request to this URL, we can pass in some additional arguments. So I can say params is equal to payload, and payload is the dictionary of the URL parameters that we want to set. So now, instead of printing out the headers down here, I'm going to print out r.text to get the response from this. So if I run this, let me make this a little larger here. So this is the response that we got back from HTTP bin. And we can see that the response said that our request had arguments of a page equal to 2 and a count equal to 25. And we can look at the request URL also and see that the library created the correct URL for us. So if I print out, instead of r.text, I print out r.url and run that, then we can see that the URL that it requested was this right here, and it has those correct URL parameters in the URL itself. So that looks exactly like it did when we put those parameters in manually, but it's not as error prone now since we're using a clean dictionary to set those. So those are GET parameters. Now, sometimes we want to post some data to a certain URL. Now, you would do something like this if you would like to post form data to a route or something like that. So I'm going to use the HTTP bin post route to show you what that would look like. So I just need to change the URL up here to /post instead of /get. And also, instead of using request.get here as our method, I'm going to use request.post instead. So if we wanted to post some data to this route, then we could simply say, instead of params equals payload here, we will set data equal to payload. So now let me change the posted data to something that would be more likely to be in a form. So for example, I could say, you know, username, whoops, let me spell that correctly. Username is equal to, we'll just do Corey, a string of Corey, and then we'll do password, and we'll just set that equal to a string of testing. So let me save that, and instead of printing out the URL here, I will print out the request.txt. So I can run that. If I scroll up, then we can see that our args, we don't have any args because those are URL parameters, in our form here. This is the data that was posted. So we have a username set to Corey and a password set to testing. And you can make those key value pairs whatever you'd like. So if you're trying to pass in certain form data, then you'll have to actually look at the HTML source code of the URL to see what values that form actually expects. Now, like I said, we're getting a JSON response back from the HTTP bin website. So JSON responses are very common when working with certain APIs. So if you get a JSON response, then instead of using .txt as the method here, you could also use a JSON method instead. So let's see what that does. So I will print out r.json, and that is a method. So we have to put parameters after that so that we execute that. So let me save that and run it. So what this did is it created a Python dictionary from that JSON response. So if I wanted to capture that in a variable, then I could say, let me make another line here. I'll say r underscore dict is equal to r.json. And now you have that JSON response captured in a Python dictionary, and you can access those values just like you would any other dictionary. So for example, I could just access the form key of that response and say print rdict and then access that form key. So if I save that and run it, then we can see that we get the posted form values from that response. Now, if you're used to using JSON in Python, then this is basically the same as importing the JSON module and then using JSON.loads on the response text. But this is just a nice little shortcut for that functionality. Okay, so we saw how to do a post request with some data. Now, if you needed to do a put request with some data, then it's basically the same thing, but instead of request.post, you would use request.put. Now, if you're performing logins, then not all of them are done through form-based authentication. Some of them are done through something called basic authentication. Now, if you need to pass credentials using basic authentication, then request can do that also. And we can also use HTTP bin to test this as well. So the way that HTTP bin allows you to test basic auth routes is that you specify the credentials in the URL that you want to test against. And then you can pass different credentials to the route to see if that works. So it'll make more sense once we take a look here. So let me actually open this up in the browser. Now, if you want to learn how any of these routes work, then you can always look in the documentation here. But we can see for the auth methods, it says if we go to /basic-auth, then /user/password, then that will prompt the user for authorization using basic auth, expecting that username and password. So let me try this out. So I'm at httpbin.org/basic-auth. And now I'll do a user of Corey, and a password of testing. So if I run that and go to that route, then we can see that when we run this, it pops up a basic authentication form here where the correct credentials are going to be the user and password that we specified in the URL. So if I put in the wrong username, so I'll say Corey MS and then a password of testing. If I try to sign in, then we can see that it shakes that off, telling us that it doesn't work. But if I put in the correct username and password, so I'll put in a username of Corey and a password of testing and sign in, then we can see that we get redirected to this page that says authenticated is true and our user is Corey. So now let's see how to do this programmatically in Python using requests. So I'm going to copy this URL so that we can use the same example in Python. So I'm going to copy this. Now I'm going to open up Sublime here. And first I'm going to create a GET request that goes to the same route that I was using in the browser. So we're using a POST request right now. So I'll change that to GET. Now I'm going to get rid of these parameters that we were testing out. Get rid of the data payload there, and let me paste in that basic authentication route that we were just using in the browser. And let me also get rid of this section where we were setting JSON there. So passing credentials for basic authentication is super simple. All we have to do is pass in some additional parameters here. And so I'll say comma for our get method. And I'll say auth is equal to, and we're going to pass in a tuple. And the tuple will be the username and the password. So the first value here is the username. So I'll say Corey. And for the password, I will say testing. So now if I come down here and do a print of r.text, if I save that and run it, then we can see that we get the response that we were expecting and that we were authenticated is set to true and the user is set to Corey. Now, if we were to use the wrong credentials, then let's see what happens. So instead of Corey as the username, I'm going to pass in Corey MS instead. So I will save that and run it. So if I run that as is, then we can see that there's no response text. So let me remove that text part from the response and just print out the response object itself. So now I'm just printing out R, which is the response. So I'll save that and run it. And when I do that, we can see that we get a response, but it has a status code of 401. And that a 401 is an unauthorized response code. So that's working the way that it should. So if I change this back and do a username of Corey instead of Corey MS and rerun this, then we can see that we get a 200 response that we'd expect from authenticating correctly. Now, one reason I actually decided to put this tutorial together was because, like I said, I was putting together a script to monitor my personal website, and I was using requests to do that. Now, one thing I noticed when writing that script that monitors my website is that requests will wait indefinitely if it's not getting a response from the page that it's trying to access. So I think it's a good idea to set a timeout if it's possible that the website won't respond in an acceptable amount of time. Because if you don't set a timeout, then it could just wait and hang forever. So to set a timeout with any request, you can simply add it as an additional parameter. So you can do that. My line is getting a little bit long here. I'm just going to remove that authentication parameter. So to put in a timeout, you can just say timeout equals like 3. So that's 3 seconds, for example. And I think we can actually see this at work too using HTTP bin. So if I go back to their website, then they do have some, let's see, I believe this is in dynamic data. They have one route where you can return a delayed response for a max of 10 seconds. So that route is at httpbin.org/delay/, and then the number of seconds that you want to delay. So if I wanted a 3 second delay, then I can run that. And after 3 seconds, this should respond. So that's about 3 seconds right there, and it responded. So if I delay by 1 second here, so I'm going to copy that URL and paste this in to my script. So we're getting a URL that has a delay of 1 second and a timeout of 3 seconds. So I'm going to run that, and we can see that the response is a 200 response. Now, what if I delay for 6 seconds? So we can imagine if it takes 6 seconds to get a URL response, that, you know, usually is going to time out for most people. Or at least I should say, if my personal website is taking 6 seconds to respond with basic HTML, then I want that to time out and tell me that it's taking that long. So if I run this, then it should hit our timeout before it actually returns that response. So we can see here that we got an exception, and the exception was a read timeout. So I think it's a good idea to add that timeout to just about every request. You know, unless you're getting a request from an API that's doing a lot of computation and you expect it to take a long time. But other than that, if something goes wrong, then it can just hang indefinitely. So you don't want that. So whenever I put out that video on my website monitoring script, then you'll see me use this so that I can be sure that if my site is taking more than so many seconds to respond, then I'll be notified about that as well. Okay, so I think that is going to do it for this video. Hopefully now you have a pretty good idea for how you can use requests to interact with these sites in the way that you want and to also get the information that you're after. Now, there's definitely some more advanced stuff that we can do with requests, but I think what we covered in this video covers about 99% of what most people will use requests for. But if there's something that I didn't cover that you'd like me to discuss further, or if you have any questions about what we covered in this video, then feel free to ask in the comment section below, and I'll do my best to answer those. And if you enjoyed enjoy these tutorials and would like to support them, then there are several ways you can do that. The easiest way is to simply like the video and give it a thumbs up. And also, it's a huge help to share these videos with anyone who you think would find them useful. And if you have the means, you can contribute through Patreon, and there's a link to that page in the description section below. Be sure to subscribe for future videos, and thank you all for watching.